Welcome to Hopkinton Coffee Break, your home for current community talk, with Patricia Duarte, Darlene Hayes, and Connie Wright.
Hi, welcome to Hopkinton Coffee Break, and we are all things Patriots winners. So exciting. It's still exciting.
It is.
I mean, it's still a big buzz on Twitter. It's a big buzz out there, and I mean, five.
Yeah, exactly.
So I have to confess, I want to go watch the game again, because I will tell you, I was so upset the first half, I kept walking away from the TV because I could not take it.
I know, it was crazy. We had a great party, and you guys were there, everybody was there, and a lot of the good friends and family, a full house, upstairs, downstairs, and it did look, I'm not a big football fan, I don't really watch the game, but this was the most exciting football game I've ever seen.
I stress ate the first half. Because I couldn't handle it. I kept walking away from the TV and eating. Yeah. It's like, oh my God.
And you and Mike are great Patriots fans, darling.
I mean, I'm a fan, but I'm not like he is. I mean, he's fanatic. Actually, I got to wear his shirt.
Yeah.
This is his Brady shirt.
Tom Terrific.
And when we had it on at your house, he had it on at your house, kind of like your husband. The shirt hadn't been washed all season because you wear it all the time and you don't jinx it. Like, we had to leave your house at halftime because when they were losing so bad,
right.
Michael had to get home to his own chair, his own pistachios, the right beer, and everything, and that's it.
Yeah, this ritual. Yeah.
And everyone had to go back to, like, what they were doing. My brother-in-law had to go from someplace he was at and get, like, he wears a Patriots ski hat backwards.
Yes.
He had to do that. There used to be, like, a couple years, a couple Super Bowls ago, that Michael wore the same underwear. And stuff like that. So, it's fine.
I'm with you. Brad, you know, he hosts this party.
Brad wash it? This has been washed since.
I have taken that sweatshirt and have washed it since. But, you know, he hosts this party every year. And, you know,
we had
about 50 people. We had a great time. You know, a food fest. Thank you, everybody. They're just wonderful. I have to shout out to Bravo Marketing's Bling. So everybody was wearing these and couldn't come in the door without them. And
Brad had his little basket there. Come on, Bling out. And he's all lit up. He had, like, light up footballs blinking.
His flare.
Let's talk about Super Bowl food.
Oh, yes.
That was kind of fun.
That is fun.
So I know everybody, you think of the wings.
Yeah.
And you think of the chili.
Yeah.
And the guacamole. And
the
dips.
And the ribs. And more chicken. And the pizza.
That when you cut it open, the M&Ms came pouring out.
And there were Patriot colors. That was kind of cool.
That was. We should share some of the photos. At least, Katie Cakes, that Super Bowl cake was amazing.
I made her cut into it because I was stress eating and I wanted to stop eating and I wanted that piece of cake. So at halftime, I made her cut it. I'm sorry. I was
bad. And the inside poured out red and blue, like M&Ms that looked like, you know, the Patriots cut. It was beautiful. Yeah. I know. It was fun. A lot of,
well, good food.
Yeah, we had a good time.
You know, it was also neat seeing how many people in Hopkinton actually were in Houston.
Yes.
I mean, there was about a dozen that I knew. And our friend, and she's actually been on the show because she does Girls on the Run. And as part of the running club is Deb Blonde Thomas.
Yes.
And that was her 50th birthday present from her husband that the six of them went. A shout out to my friend Cheryl Tuttle in Houston, who actually took in New England people to stay at her home.
Chris Halloran had a gaggle there with her husband.
Lisa Hamblet went
with them. And then there was, I'm forgetting all the names. There was a whole gaggle of you guys.
even Lisa Nickerson that we've had on the show,
right,
she was there.
Exactly.
And
did anybody steal Brady's jersey? I want to know.
I think it's misplaced.
Any Hopkintonian steal Brady's jersey? You confess up. We won't tell.
And then she wants it.
Right. I know.
I mean, when you heard about that story, I mean, the memorabilia experts were saying, you know, if it could really be resold, it's worth about $500,000.
Yeah.
But it can't be resold.
Because so everyone knows about it.
So it's actually worthless. It's, you know, got zero value. And my husband's like, yeah, if I had it, I'd have it hanging in the den and only show like three or four people, but it'd be mine. It'd be mine. I'm like, good job.
But it is a game that I actually did watch again on the NFL channel.
Oh!
Not the whole thing, but in the way that they had it edited, you didn't have the big pauses.
Yeah.
I mean, so they really did show you. Because I could, the day after, not knowing football really well, and I was like, remind me, Brad, what was the turning point? What was the play or whatever? And seeing it the
Edelman.
Second time.
Oh Edelman. God.
that catch that was like, it didn't fall, it didn't fall, it didn't fall.
Yeah, that was crazy. Yeah. So half the party left, you know, like Mike wanted to, people wanted to get back to, you know, they figured we were going to lose. We were at 28 to 9 or something.
28 to 3. But
then it went to 9. I think that was when.
We missed the extra point, you're right.
And then folks were saying, oh, well, you know, it's getting late, you know, I need to get home and so forth. So folks were doing that. And then we still had about 30 people that were still there. So that the roof was raised when the change happened. And by that time, I could sit down and really, you know, watch it.
I couldn't go to sleep after the game ended because my adrenaline was so up. I had another hour and a half of just like, what am I going to do? So I had to listen to all the interviews, which I normally don't listen to because at a certain point it's repetition. But for an hour and a half,
it's
kept
watching. It's kind of like yesterday listening to like the weather report.
Oh, my God, all day long.
Over the TV, it's like, yeah, it's snowing. I got it. It's snowing. Oh, wow, yeah, it's still snowing.
But the parade in Boston looked awesome.
And that was another thing where there were tons and tons of hockey. And people who actually pulled their kids out of school to go because it's one of those things that is a lasting memory. Mm-hmm. I mean, Gail and Mark Bell were there. They were fortunate to be inside for it, but I know, you know, the Desolates were there. And, like, Beth Oliva, who we've had on the show, who's done hometown hospitality, she took her son out of school.
Yeah.
And basically, I think she's going for, like, the Mom of the Year award for doing it. her and her son went and...
She and her son had a good time. Everybody had a good time.
You know, we'll actually post up a couple of pictures. Denise Antica, I say her last name wrong, Annika. Antaki. Denise Antaki.
Oh,
she was there, and she actually got herself there hours early.
Oh, she's
and
great.
So she got really good pictures and little good clips, and so they're actually going to be inserted in the show, so you'll see. But she was able to get, like in front of the reviewing stands, selfie stands, and things like that, which is really cool.
She's fun.
And, you know, the day before was truck day. So, like, Monday was truck day, and then the next day.
Well, now explain for those who don't know what truck day is.
Truck day is for Fenway. Is at Fenway Park.
Oh, okay.
Is when they pack up the 18-wheeler trucks. There's two of them that go down.
Okay.
And it's all the stuff for getting ready for
spring
training.
Oh, okay.
Because catchers and reporters report in, like, 2.5 weeks.
Pitchers, well, I know everyone's been counting down to that because that's a sure sign of spring, but I didn't know about truck day.
Yeah, so Super Bowl Sunday, truck day Monday, Super Bowl parade Tuesday. Now, I do want to back up to the Super Bowl because the other side of the Super Bowl, which I always enjoy, are the ads.
Oh, yeah.
And this year was interesting. The ads were... some of them were, you've seen them before, others were.
Well, I didn't have a favorite this year, though. I don't know, and I never really get to sit down, you know, hosting, see each one of them. Did you have anyone that you liked in particular?
The theme this year was a lot of.
Another dancing around politics, of course.
Of course. Well, a lot of it around just, in general, inequality theme, pushing rights, but it was quite interesting to see that these were legit businesses that were promoting these various themes.
Well, I mean, it would be legit for sure.
I think the Hyundai commercial was probably one of my favorites.
Yeah.
Oh. The Hyundai one where they, you know, took, you know, three soldiers and put them in isolation rooms that were in Afghanistan, and they were in 360 rooms, and then they took their families to the Super Bowl and put them in suites, but they had 360 cameras, so it was like virtual reality that they were actually there with their families, so they could turn, and their families there, and they could have virtual hugs, and that was cool. And that Hyundai didn't actually put one car or their word at all.
Yeah, that's powerful.
And that one aired right as the game ended, and it was live.
Oh, okay.
So what you got was there were two live commercials, that one and Snickers.
And they did it, so they did all the taping of it during the first quarter.
Yeah.
They had to have it ready. And it was weird when the producer was talking, you know, he goes, Hyundai had to approve it. The Super Bowl had to approve it. He goes, I had to send it to my mother to approve it. And stuff like that to make sure that, you know, they got it. But
well, what was the commercial about with Melissa McCarthy?
Oh, the Kia.
I didn't really get it.
That was her. So she was in an eco-friendly car.
Yeah.
And she kept getting the call to fight for the, you know,
environment,
the ecology. And so she kept, you know, save the whale, save the trees.
But she was getting, like, beat up or plummeted around. I didn't get that.
Yeah, so she was imagining in her head, every time she got the call, that she would be this eco warrior and all these horrible things happen. And then in the end, it was, well, we can't all be eco warriors, but at least you can drive an eco-friendly car. Lord. That was the point of that one.
Well, I hope that everybody got it. It was funny. Yeah, I don't know. I wasn't really sure.
You know, and then when you say something like that, the amount of money people invest into them to have that kind of airtime, and it's the most expensive airtime of the year.
In the world,
So, and in the world.
Right.
And that, you know, you if you missed your message or missed your mark, oops, on. I mean, you know, I think people like the, you know, the Mr. Clean ad and the Doritos ads and things like that, too.
I like the Audi ad. I thought it was a great ad.
Yeah.
I thought that it was pretty powerful.
Now, what was that real quick?
That was essentially talking about equal pay for women. You know, do I tell her that her grandfather is worth more than her grandmother, that her mother is worth less than I am? Do I tell her, you know, and she wins the Soapbox Derby race.
Oh,
and,
that one, yes.
You know, and that was kind of cool.
Yeah.
I liked the 84 Lumber ad. And you had to go online to see the ending. And, you know, it was controversial, but it was, I guess what I liked were the ads that made you stop and think.
Well, that's what they tend to try to do.
And made you really contemplate and challenge.
I think about the ads from previous years, like when the Apple commercial came out.
84.
And was that 84? And, you know, it's like some kind of, you know, I don't know, future world type of effect. And that certainly made you think. And, you know. So, yeah, I guess.
From 84 to now, Apple has pretty much taken over a lot of the world.
That's right. That's right.
I mean, really, if you think when it came, started off with those colored boxes.
Exactly.
And stuff like that that were on our desks, too.
Well, you know, I'll date myself, but you know, back in the day, I actually met Steve Jobs at a job fair in Silicon Valley in the 80s.
But, no way!
Yeah, but, I mean, not met like as in shook his hand, but he was there. Just, you know, Apple was not that big of a deal then. And we were, you know, Cray Research, and we were flexing, and, you know, IBM was there, and Wang was there, and DEC was there, and Apple was there. So, of course, he was there with a bunch of other techies behind the desk.
See, I'm going to disagree that you were at the big company, but
I
was working in San Francisco at the time, and we were a very forward in technology thinking CPA firm. It was then Touche Rossignol Deloitte & Touche. We were one of the first to use computers and to have automated audit procedures. And so we had Macintoshes, and we had VisiCalc.
Oh, Lord.
Precursor to things like Excel spreadsheets to do the math behind some of our stuff.
We'll have to do a
show
one time.
Oh, my goodness. I wish I had kept some of those old.
Oh, I still have them.
Oh, my word.
So what else is going on? So we football, and that's,
well,
you know.
Yeah.
And
well,
the snowstorm.
So we go from the day after the parade to 50 degrees.
I know, right. Wasn't it nice and warm?
Balmy.
Yeah, I was, you know.
Exactly.
And, you know, on that 50-degree day, it was warm. The ground had, you know, thawed out.
Yeah, after
and,
the.
And so, you know, that was a day that, you know, these arrived at my house. And you might see some of these popping up all over the community. But these are basically signs of, you know, welcoming and inclusion. If anyone's interested in them, you know, get in touch with one of us. We know where they are and can help you get one. But I was able to get mine in the ground the day before the snow. And so,
nice,
you know,
messaging.
To go to where, you know, today it is, a, you know, 14 inches of snow yesterday to a minus 11 wind chill today.
Well, back on the sign, though, the purpose is not at the exclusion of, but it's at the inclusion of where an inclusive community, kindness, acceptance, diversity. It's a broad message.
There's definitely
And I think
a lot
people can take it for what they want. And I think if they want, you know, if they're interested in one, they can reach out. And it's just
exactly.
Yeah.
You know, these are interesting times, and folks are in all arenas are talking about what does it mean to be inclusive, and I really just appreciate how the variety of people came together just to think about how do we just acknowledge that what's special about Hopkinton really is our community, the warmth, the friendships, regardless of political affiliation, and these signs that people are really excited to have pop up will just underscore that is the intent.
Well,
and there'll be some in Hopkinton, there'll be a lot in Hopkinton, but there's some going into Holliston and Southboro, and a few in Upton and Ashland, that different people, when they found out about it, really wanted to get on board.
Well, and I know I've been challenged about, well, why do we need a sign? But you did say it was interesting times. And while I would suggest that we shouldn't have to state these things, and you know, it has become important to actually make these affirmative statements mm-hmm. about these things.
Right. So positive, inclusive, you know, values.
And they're positive. They're not at the exclusion
of anyone.
At the inclusion of is really what it's about.
Trying to be intentional.
And kindness matters.
And absolutely. And towns are doing this all over the place. I mean, we're seeing, you know.
Right. I mean, the thing is, yes.
In terms of,
you know,
our businesses.
Mm-hmm. You know,
it's
may have been part of the ones behind getting these signs.
Right.
But this isn't something that.
We didn't write
this. We didn't design this. But this was out there.
It's actually has a large presence in the Mid-Atlantic area. Mm-hmm. So in homes in Jersey, Delaware, and Maryland, these are actually extremely popular right now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they actually started in Jersey.
Ah.
Yeah. So the this is written up a whole lot of different ways, different knockdown in white, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, some people add different lines. Is that this is just, you know, one that we that
yeah,
was
right.
lifted and that, you know, seemed to cover the bill of, you know, acceptance.
Well, yeah, and
absolutely.
Kudos to you for getting the ball rolling on it. And then
absolutely.
We had the snowstorm.
Yeah.
Snowstorm. Now I got a question. When you find yourself in school's out, you know, school's canceled, work is canceled, you got to work remotely. I think everybody out there has. I was talking about this yesterday. I know I have certain things I do, and it's kind of comfort. It's reminiscent of my youth.
Mm-hmm.
So I made a homemade beef stew. I didn't do my stereotypical bread baking because I decided that would not be good given the eating, particularly stress eating at the Super Bowl.
Food is one thing,
but
the idea of snow day. And, you know, I loved your post and your comment, Darlene, about, you know, snow day being like living inside a globe.
Mm-hmm.
You're with the most people that you love, and you're encased in this warm, loving.
You're in a snow globe.
You're in a snow
globe. But they're magical. Like, everything stops.
Yeah.
And, you know,
mm-hmm.
it doesn't, you know, outside of, like, if someone had to get to a hospital and things like
right.
that, or, like, you know, usually my husband has to work, but for the most part, you're in a snow globe,
mm-hmm.
and the whole world is kind of at a standstill.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
they interrupt television all day long to talk about snow. So, you know, whether it's movies or things like that, but, you know, I still get excited. I mean, my bedroom and my parents' bedroom were right next to each other,
mm-hmm.
and my mother had a clock radio that was set for WSRS, and that's how you would hear snow cancellations, and you'd try to stay awake while they were playing, because there was no TV, they weren't being tickered on TV,
right, right.
you know, and, you know, it was actually, so you know, it's like, okay, Acton, Amesbury, and then if you dozed off, oh no, did I miss it? You'd hear Bedford come up, I'm like, did I miss
like
it? And you have to go through the whole list again, but I still get excited when I see, like, Ashland pop up, or things
right.
like that. Because it's like, you know, it's like you don't get out of pajamas, you're going to just...
So that, and you were talking about food, and your husband being in the grocery business, you know how the whole world goes to get food the day before.
Milk and bread. It's like,
milk
really?
And bread and really? Crumbs.
All of New England was having French toast or pancakes.
I was like, really?
Exactly.
But I will say, and let's give a shout out, because yesterday, there are people that work, and they work long
oh, yes.
and hard. All of our first responders, all the plow guys out
DPW,
there.
Absolutely.
The
DPW.
You know,
I saw the head of DPW at Price Shoppers, John Westmoreland.
Yeah,
super nice guy. And, you know, he was getting stuff and hurrying off. But
it's kind of funny. Like, you know, the day before,
mm-hmm.
the store's nuts.
Yes.
Now, Michael had to go in yesterday,
mm-hmm.
and he was absolutely just bored to tears because nobody was coming in, but they had to be
because
the trucks are still coming in, and because it's produce and meats and fish, you have to, like, unload it because you can't just leave it there.
Absolutely.
But, you know, I think
the
we were fortunate.
Yeah.
We have pretty clear roads. You know, there's going to be a little more cleanup, but the roads are pretty clear.
But shout out to our DPW. They take care of us. I think they do a marvelous job.
Well, and they always hire
all the windy roads.
Well, and they take on... contractors
to
marshal
the roads
clean and
yeah.
everything. They work hard.
Yep.
But now we have a bright sunshiny day.
It's gorgeous.
And yeah, and it's
always
bitter cold.
It's bitter cold. This is
after 55 degrees 3 days ago.
We call this Minnesota weather. This is exactly what we moved from. Living 14 years in Minneapolis. This is what every winter day is like.
High winds.
Bright blue skies. I mean, people, you know, have ruddy red cheeks and tan faces because of the, you know, sunny, bright weather against the snow. Absolutely. And this frigid cold. But people are out. The air just, I said, to myself, this is Minnesota weather, totally.
Well, yesterday we did go, I went out for a walk
I saw
with
your
John,
picture. Yeah.
And well, he posted it. We went for a walk in the woods, but I got to tell you today,
yeah, this is a
perfect
day
to go out.
Just bundle
on
up.
The trails, hike, yeah. Yeah. Stay warm. But a lot of fun.
Well, so. Speaking of warmth, coming up, Valentine's Day will be, you know, on everyone's, or ought to be on everyone's lips.
And we'll try to post up tomorrow at the HCA.
Anything going on?
There's a lot going on. Yeah. I think in regards to Valentine's Day, Swoon is having like a Valentine's sale and a winter sale. Oh. But if you go on Sunday from, I think it's 1 to 4 or 12 to
at
4
Swoon. Mm-hmm.
At Swoon. It's actually a fundraiser for the Boston Red Sox Foundation. So not only are they having a great sale, you can put a honey-do wish together, you know, a honey wish list if you want.
Yeah.
But the on top
honey
of it,
bye.
You know, you're also benefiting the Red Sox Foundation, which is the Jimmy Fund. I know that even Stephanie G, that's in the Building of Age Cam, has got some really great specials going on. Marty's is stocked with booze and things like that. But
Katie Cakes out there probably cranking a beautiful
Sugar Mom is doing her
Sugar
cupcakes
Mama.
And stuff.
But tomorrow is the Love Letters event.
Yeah, okay. That's at HCA. Then, and
put
I love
on by the Diversity.
Hopkinton Diversity and Cultural Alliance is overseeing that. And
they're writing letters about to whom?
I don't know.
Okay, but
I don't know.
Yeah,
we'll get it up.
Yeah, we'll share because I'm sure they're doing something.
And
cool.
I love when the HCA is actually getting utilized a lot.
Yeah.
So I mean, you know, I saw whether it was Amy Rittenbusch did a traffic study there this past Monday.
EHOP.
Wonderful. Which was Educate Hopkinton. So most people who don't realize that EHOP was Educate Hopkinton and followed it, but. You know, to where it's going this Sunday. And Sunday, you know, they have the jazz from 10 to 1.
Yeah.
And in one part of the building upstairs, and then downstairs it flips to the prince or princess
tea.
The tea. It looks adorable.
It's almost like a dance setup.
Yeah.
A friend of ours, Lorelei Laughlin, is actually the fairy princess mother, like the godmother going around with a wand. And she'll actually be hosting the next book group that we're doing for RHH.
What would you say?
It's Princess Warriors.
You're going to be there?
So I know that the last time we talked about that, we've been reading Hank Philby Ryan's book, and that was part of our book club.
Yes.
And then we asked someone to raise their hand at the book club to pick the next one and host.
Yes.
And so Lorelei Laughlin, and she's hosting on the 28th, but she picked Night Circus.
Okay.
And it's written by Erin Morgenstern.
Well, let me see.
A local writer in state here.
Is that she used to live in Massachusetts. She's from Marblehead and lives in Manhattan now.
So
Night trying to stay with the theme of women that are writers and authors that have a New England focus.
Well, just to add, haunts and bewitches on every page.
Yes.
I mean, that's what this is.
She's
about.
A North Shore.
Magical, enchanting, spellbinding, and mesmerizing. Sounds like a good read.
Yeah, so Night Circus by Erin Morgenstern.
Yeah.
And so, and we'll post it up on the Real Housewives page more. There's an event page already up there.
Yeah.
We'll have the book club on this on February 28th.
Yeah, so people can come to any book club as they're announced and so forth. It's a very...
It's a fun social.
It's a fun social. Get out, read or not read, but do read.
And there's a lot of stuff that's coming up. I mean, the Faith Community Church has the annual teddy bear picnic that we haven't been to in... Oh my gosh, I guess it's about a dozen years. But I mean, we went every year for when they were real little.
Yeah.
The 25th anniversary of the Hopkinton Educational Foundation Gala will be in March, and it's coming up in March.
I should send them some pictures of when we used to go.
Oh, my gosh.
I found them recently.
No way.
No. I'll have to show them to you.
We would do neighborhood.
The adult prom.
The Hopkinton adult prom.
Two tables from our neighborhood, at least sometimes three.
That was a sought-after ticket.
Well, and coming up soon is that really important holiday that I know everybody is waiting for because it's just on my calendar, Fastnacht Day.
Oh.
Of course.
Now
what is that?
Spell it. Spell it first of all.
Fastnacht, because I'm Pennsylvania Dutch.
And it's
the day before Lent and us.
You mean what we call Fat Tuesday?
Fat Tuesday, Shrove Tuesday. and we make this potato donut, and it's
she
called
She has been making it for years.
And it's what you do before you start fasting.
So, you know, we're going to have to showcase some of those traditions. Fasnacht and, you know, Fat Tuesday.
I'm going to have to make some
Mardi Gras. We should bring some Mardi Gras to H-Town.
Oh, goodness. That'd be fun.
Wouldn't that be?
A little bit of New Orleans.
Exactly. You know, I'm all about the food.
Fasching, Mardi Gras.
Get the cake with the baby in it.
What?
Oh, the king cake.
The king cake.
Oh, yeah, with the little, okay,
the
nativity.
When she's a baby in a
piece of the nativity scene or something. Oh, my God.
Don't eat it.
Oh, I know. Wow.
You know, and some of those traditions.
To me,
it's like we had Groundhog's Day. Yes, damn it, Groundhog.
Because that
we
happened
have
in
six
Pennsylvania,
more.
Too, right.
Pennsylvania fell.
Right. I never really fully understood what it is.
Not Pennsylvania, Punxsutawney, sorry.
Same dip.
Yeah, you know, it's okay. I can make poke fun of myself.
Yeah,
Pennsylvania, we're a little bit of, you know.
Well, we got, you know, you got to make it fun in February because, you know,
it's winter
and it's getting long.
Yeah. And, you know, and we talk about the HC a lot. So also coming up would be, you know, in a couple of weeks, Barbara Kessler has another of her open mic nights coming up. And, you know,
just
in a,
nice reminder that there's live music in town. And these are opportunities to come out and hear.
Oh, and
we're professionals, actually.
We're having a guest on the show in a couple of weeks, Erin Mahoney, who is actually a local author who's done Girl Power. Mm-hmm. And she'll talk about that. But she's a lot of people already know her in town, even though she doesn't live in Hopkinton, because she's run the program, the Girl Power programs at Hopkins and Elmwood for the last years, and just got a grant in the Midwest that we'll talk about.
Okay.
And there we have it.
Happy Valentine's Day.
Yes.
Happy Super Bowl 51. Patriots 555. Let's go for 666.
Love is everything. Happy Valentine's Day.
Possibility. It starts early, before we even know what it is. Thanks to people.
Do you have what it takes?
Will you make a difference?
Always an adventure.
Police and fire working together.
Utilizing the latest technology.
Do you have what it takes?